Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. You are in for quite a treat. I want you to note in the pews there are some cards that are beginning to appear more and more each week that you can put in the offering plate. I give electronically. So if you do your giving that way, you still have some way to participate in the offering portion of the service. For those of you at home, you'll want to have your communion elements ready. So some kind of wine or juice, some kind of bread or cracker would be perfect. Everyone is welcome at Holy Communion. Let us enjoy our call to worship.
That was beautiful. Thank you so much. I have a few announcements for you. Today is Stewardship Sunday, and if you didn't pick up your statement of giving before the service, please do so after the service, or will they need it during the service? I'm not sure. You'll need it during the service, so there may be an opportunity to pick up your statement. I believe they're at the back of the sanctuary. Next weekend is Reformation Sunday, and so remember to wear red. That will be the color of the day. Next week is also Trunk or Treat Sunday from 4 to 6 p.m. We'll have our cars in the parking lot with the back of the vehicles open and decorated, and treats and candy handed out to all who come. So it's always a fun event, and everyone is welcome. The Awe Committee, the Arts and Worship Environment Committee, is preparing for All Saints Sunday, and they would like your help. There is a table in the back of the sanctuary where you can write the name of a loved one who has passed on an angel. These angels will be hung in the sanctuary the weekend of November 5th and 6th. Please complete your angel by Monday, October 31st, and thanks for helping with this remembrance. Your disaster preparedness committee is working on the plan to have Trinity ready for a very basic level one disaster response. We'll be collecting items to have available to support electronics charging, access to water, and overnight parking. The details and the list of items we hope to secure through donations is in this week's Trinity Times, and they may be brought at any time to the reception room down the hallway. We're still looking for favorite songs for November, so please continue to send them in. Thank you to Stewardship Committee for greeting and hosting this week's coffee hour. It'll be in the fellowship hall. And there are items on the breast cancer awareness table out there at the top of the ramp. You're free to take them as you wish, except for the mannequin. Please don't take the mannequin. And the altar flowers are in celebration of our breast cancer survivors. Thank you.
Also, in preparation for All Saints Day, we will be setting up a Day of the Dead display again this year, so you are welcome to bring pictures of your loved ones who have died at any time, and we'll be putting those up on our La Frenta, I think that's what it's called. I know Sterling's going to correct me later. So you can do that anytime, starting this week or next Sunday in preparation, because the All Saints Day is actually the very first day of November, but we celebrate it the first Sunday of November. So anytime you want to bring those would be perfect. I invite you to rise in body or spirit for our confession and forgiveness. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister, and by his authority, and by Christ's authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sin, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us sing our gathering song, Rise, O Son of Righteousness, verses 1 and 5. It's hymn 657 in your red hymnal. The grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, our righteous judge, daily your mercies surprise us with everlasting forgiveness. Strengthen our hope in you, and grant that all the people of the earth may find their glory in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
I invite the children forward. Yeah, you know what to do. And all those who are young at heart, we're a little bit squeezed in here, but that's all right. Good morning, good morning, welcome. All right, let's start passing the microphone so you can say your names, and as the others come up, then we'll get their names too.
Ryder.
That's Lucas.
Sterling.
Avery.
Hudson.
Oh, maybe they like it that way.
Sophia.
Sophia. All right, go ahead. Can you say it nice and loud? Your name?
Rebecca.
Very good. All right, one more.
Amelia.
Amelia. Very good. Very good to have you here today. Today is Stewardship Sunday. It does, steward is kind of a weird word we don't use very much. You might hear, I don't know, I probably don't even talk about stewardesses on planes anymore. Flight attendants is what it is now. A steward is someone who takes care of something. And we all take care of each other. How about anything that you are, that you have to take care of? Anybody? Yeah, what do you take care of, Ryder?
Cats.
You are a steward of your cats. And if you're not a good steward, they will let you know. Yes, how about you?
Your sisters.
Your sisters, right. You are a steward of your sister. Very good. And if you don't take care of her, she will let you know. Right? Yes. Your family. You are a steward of your family. Lucas?
A tortoise.
Steward of a tortoise. Very good. Anybody else? Very good. We are good stewards, and we're stewards of each other. And the folks here, they're going to be making some commitments today about how to be a steward of our church. And when we're stewards with our church, that means we help our church to help other people and to do God's work. And, you know, some of you may have an allowance, but some of you may not. But there are ways that you can be a steward, too. And so I wanted to invite you. I was looking through my cupboards today, and I thought, well, we might not be eating all of this. And, you know, there's hungry people, and we should be stewards of our neighbors and help them to have some food when they don't have any. You probably have a can of something in your cupboard that you don't like, right? Yeah. This is the perfect opportunity to say, hey, this would be great. Let's take this to church and give it to someone who needs it. Or you could get something you do like. Here's a cake mix. Sometimes when people don't have enough to eat, they like to celebrate a birthday too. Maybe they'd like a cake mix or some frosting. Or you bring your very favorite food, right? Because you know that somebody else is going to love to have this too. This is one of Sterling's favorite foods, which is why I brought it today. We have a backup can in our cupboard, so we brought the extra.
And what about this mac and cheese?
Yeah, that's a favorite too. Don't worry. Whatever you bring, we'll replace. So there's a box right behind you. And anytime you want, you can bring a can of food or a package of something, some dry food, and you can put it in that barrel for stewardship. Does anybody want to take any of these and put them in to practice? And you can do that anytime during church. Sometimes you're here for the offering and sometimes you're not. Make sure everybody has something to put in there. And when you get back from your children's time from Sunday school and confirmation, anytime during a hymn,
you can carefully
put
those cans of food in there.
I think my batteries are going out. No, it's just me. So you are all stewards, and you're taking care of our neighbors. And those will get donated to Zarephath Ministries, which is just across the way, and they feed people every day of the week. Feed people. And people are hungry, and we would all like them to have enough to eat, wouldn't we? To be good stewards for our neighbors. Well, I really appreciate your help today. Should we have a prayer? I know, I should know better than to ask that question. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you, for making us stewards. Amen. All right, you can go off to your classes.
Hey. Although our iniquities, O Lord, for your name's our apostasy, we have sinned against you. O hope of Israel, of trouble, land, like a trap. Why should you be like used? Not you, in the midst of us, and we are called by not for. Concerning this people, truly they have loved to wander. They have not eat their. Now he will iniquity and punish sins. Rejected Judah, Zion. Why have you struck us? There's no healing for us. We look for peace. Instead, our wickedness, the iniquity of our ancestors, for we have sinned against you. Turn us for your name. Honor your glorious throne. Remember and do. Can any idols of the nations bring rain? Give showers. Is it not you? Lord our God, we set our hope on you, for it is you who do all this. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
And now it's time for a temple talk, I believe.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Chuck Maservey, for those of you that don't know. Curtis Hansen asked me to take a few minutes to review some of our finances in conjunction with our stewardship efforts for the coming year. To overview our finances from the expense side, we need to go back to the year 2017 to look at a year with what would be considered typical full year expenses. In 2017, our expenses were about $337,000. Then we began to see some atypical years with changes in our pastors and COVID. The next year that had a more typical set of expenses was in 2020. Even though we were dealing with COVID that year, we saw actual expenses of $340,000, This $340,000 of expenses for 2020 was if you factor out the Payroll Protection Program, or PPP loan, that helped pay for about $30,000 of our payroll expenses for that year. For several of the last 5 years, the effects of COVID and searching for a new pastor have had the effect of temporarily reducing our annual expenses during some of the years. We have turned the page on these times and are now on the threshold of some exciting new times for Trinity. Looking at our current situation for 2022, we have an expense budget of $371,255. Through September, we have seen actual expenses for the year of $265,693, while having contributions of $247,573. This leaves us with a year-to-date deficit of $18,120. When considering our expenses, we need to recognize that our personnel expenses are the largest portion of this. We now have a full staff that includes our gifted and experienced Pastor Amy. We also have a knowledgeable lay staff with Rachel as our office manager bookkeeper and Stephanie as our director of faith formation. At the same time, we are fortunate to have a group of talented and inspiring musicians, who we just heard this morning, who lead and direct our musical groups with Connie, Scott, and Sam. We have been able to attract these valuable people to Trinity, even while many other churches and businesses struggle to find employees. With a full staff and full schedule of activities, we will be experiencing similar expenses during the next year as we have seen in 2022. In 2023, we again need to recognize our need to support our staff and personnel expenses that make up the largest part of our budget. We are now in our annual pledge program to help us plan our finances for the coming year. One of the ways we can help show our support for our church and staff is to participate in this effort. I ask you to prayerfully consider how you can contribute to help support our efforts and arrive at a budget that will enable us to continue to grow our mission in the coming year. As part of the process, I invite you to participate in our pledge program for the next year, experience the joy we receive from giving thanks to God. Thanks for your continuing support.
The second reading is from 2 Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Raise for the cause of life.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus: God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Did you hear our beautiful double duet? Somewhere Over the Rainbow. And I have been inspired this week by that song. Many times films reflect our common values, and that's certainly part of the reason why The Wizard of Oz has become a classic film. The song Somewhere Over the Rainbow expresses this deep longing for a future of hope and wholeness, a dream of a teenage girl and maybe even our nation or our world. Longing for health, life, and wholeness is something that is expressed by God throughout the scripture. I can just imagine God singing this song and even making the rainbow, right? God casts a vision throughout the scriptures in the book of Revelation, in which God will make God's home among God's people. There will be no crying or pain. Death will be no more, and God will make all things new. In Isaiah, he expresses God's vision to the people of the Hebrew scriptures that a righteous branch will spring up from the stump of Jesse, and the wolf will lie down with the lamb, and the earth will be filled with the knowledge of God, and no one will harm anyone. In the reading from 2 Timothy today, the writer has a vision of the crown of righteousness for all who have longed for God's reign. Maybe you have that longing, sung that song, longing in your heart, longing for earth, for healing for the earth, for healing for divided families, an end to disease, compassion for prisoners and people on the streets. That is what the song Somewhere Over the Rainbow is all about. It's that longing for healing and wholeness. Dorothy, she sings this song, a farm girl in the Dust Bowl days, affected by everyone around her, but she's not really given a way to use her gift. She's kind of dismissed, you know, don't bother us, we're working. She's caught in these kind of power struggles of her neighbors, caught in the storms of Kansas, caught in the destruction of the earth by these growing farms that are needing to feed a growing nation and not really knowing how to be sustainable. She's caught between childhood and adulthood. She has some tenuous comforts, but we start to see how tenuous they are when the tornado comes and picks up her house, right? Or when her dog is taken away. She wants to belong. She wants to contribute. She wants to be part of community. She wants to feel part of something. She wants to feel at home. Even though she's at home, she's not really at home, right? Often in literature and life, longing is expressed by people that are kind of on the margins, on the outside a little bit. And even though she's the central character to this story, in her own life, I think she feels like she's sidelined all the time. Those who are comfortable or are empowered probably don't speak up that much, or to dream of something more, or to be encouraged to name their dream. In The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy, as a character on the margins, expresses her dream. She's a teenager. Now, teenagers they didn't really become a thing until The Catcher in the Rye, which was about 10 years later, I think. But I'm wondering if this film started to define what a teenager is, caught in the middle like that, not a child, not an adult. She's female, a group who got the right to vote less than 20, they had the right to vote only 20 years at this point, so they're just starting to figure out who they are and how to make up their own mind and how they can come together to make a difference. She has certain work that she can do, but there's so much of the world kept from her, and she feels that, and that's why she needs to venture out, why she leaves home, why she wants to go and travel the world and see the wonders. She's on the margins. In the scriptures, the dream comes from God pushed to the margins. Now, God is very powerful, but often we're pushing God away because we don't want to hear what God has to say. It makes us uncomfortable. God is one, not appreciated, always the spurned lover, the one wanting more for the people, but ignored. The prophets, they're chosen to bring God's message. We know what happens to them. They are ignored. They are killed. They're run out of the city. And it's in the Gospels, it's the marginalized folks who see and express a vision. The Samaritan woman had a vision of healing for her daughter, as did the centurion. These are people who are despised and on the margins. The woman at the well, she has a vision for the waters of life for her whole community. The lepers, they have a vision in which they'll be healed and part of community, and it makes them take a beautiful risk and ask Jesus for healing. These beautiful visions are part of God's vision of abundant life and community and healing. The vision for the gospel today comes from a marginalized man. This tax collector, he has a hope and a vision that things won't always be the way they are, that he won't feel so separated from God and from his community. His cry to me really reminded me of the criminal on the cross next to Jesus when he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He admitted his sin, his need. Both of these folks, right, the one on the cross and the tax collector, neither of them deserved to be treated better, and yet they asked for mercy. The one on the cross had a vision of God's kingdom, and he was content to simply be a memory there, but Jesus takes it up a notch, right? Not just a memory, a relationship, abundant life, that they will be together in paradise. So beautiful, those gaps closed. The vision for the Pharisee is that he will continue to climb the ladder of importance and be better than other people. Not really a vision at all. It's just more of the same, and it's unsustainable, because sooner or later you're going to miss a rung on that ladder, and we are all coming down off our high horses in the kingdom of God. We are all humbled before Jesus. Sooner or later, we will not wield the power due to illness or age or reverse of fortunes. It's going to happen. So it's just unsustainable. Now, when I think about the Pharisee, I'm like, okay, who is that character in The Wizard of Oz? And I think there's two. And one is the Wicked Witch, of course. And the other, I think, is the wizard. These two kind of occupy that place of the Pharisee. Both are characters of power. They have subjects. They are better, more removed, protected. They have subjugated people to gain power for themselves. And one is a little more wicked, right in the name. So we should be able to pick up on that cue. The other one, he kind of cast himself in a better light, but I think he is still a Pharisee. And they both, they have a chance to be better, and one decides not to, and that gets taken care of, bucket of water, and the other one gets revealed, right? And it's the least powerful character in the whole movie, the little dog Toto, who gets to take down the bigwig, right? And pull that curtain aside and reveal him as being like everyone else and in need like everyone else. In the Bible, the heroes and the heroines, it's so fun to read the Bible because it's just the people that are unexpected. It's that twist, right? People who are lacking, who are in need. Because of their need, they see something, hope for something, work for something that powerful, rich people do not. And they share in God's dream that things will be different, and they're motivated to work toward that or let God work toward them or a little bit of both. They are the children, the widows, the foreigners, the despised, those who are grieving. And the heroes and heroines in The Wizard of Oz are centered also because of their lack, right? They're all missing something, and that's what brings them together. They are, so this is what helps them focus on the vision, right? That they're missing something. It makes them long for something more. Dorothy needs to get home. The Scarecrow needs a brain. The Cowardly Lion needs his courage. The Tin Man needs a heart. And what good things for us Christians to pursue as well, right? Brain, courage, heart, home. When we look at God's dream and the kingdom God is building of abundant life, we're not there yet. We're on the yellow brick road, and we're all there because we're not there yet and because we lack something. So we need each other on this road. We need, home is the there that we're going to, and to get there, brains, right? That's great. God gave us brains, and I love being Lutheran because you're allowed to use your brain. Hallelujah. You're supposed to use it. Very good. There's plenty of others that do as well, but let's not say we're better than anyone else. People can use, we can have faith and reasoning and thought. We can use discernment to sort out what is true and what is a lie, what is a reliable source and what is distracting and inviting us. We need our brains. God gave them to us to understand our world. And there's some things we can't understand through our brains, right? And so we need our hearts. We need morals and ethics that come through our hearts. Compassion, common ideals that guide our thinking to guide us forward. And I tell you, we need a lot of courage too, because the road is hard and there are lots of obstacles in the way. Evil and selfishness and distractions and arguments, and we get in our own way. So we have this vision of God's somewhere over the rainbow, somewhere over the promise, in the unknown. We have our eyes on the vision, and as we step into that vision, we begin to see the colors appearing. Remember the first time you saw The Wizard of Oz? And every time after that, too, the anticipation of that moment when she steps out of that threshold, all the green, all the colors, all, it's so shiny there. It's beautiful. And we start down that yellow brick road with the cheers from our friends who share a common vision. We join together in our needs with others who share the vision. And we encounter those who don't share it, who see it as a threat. And we meet the witch and the wizard, who are oblivious and have their own vision of controlling everything. And it isn't just other people that fall into the trap of the witch, the wizard, and the Pharisee. It's every single one of us. It's so easy to do. When we start comparing ourselves to others and using each other to step on to gain power, we take our eyes off the vision and we hurt each other and we put ourselves at the center, worship our ability to be better than others, which is idolatry and exhausting to try to keep up. One of those self-centered characters in the film is finally able to admit his need when he is confronted. Toto reveals the wizard as an ordinary man, and Dorothy, of course, reads him the riot act. There, that is appropriate sometimes. And he has to admit that he's no better than other people and that it was all an illusion, a trick. He, too, is in need of a home, and now he can join the vision of others on the quest. For our churches, we love our church. And we want to project health and wholeness and maybe a little perfection. We want to attract new people to join our church, but we also need to be honest about our needs and limits and seek God's vision together. We'd like to say we're glad we're not like those other churches that aren't welcoming to all, but we can't be building ourselves up in comparison to others. We need to keep our eyes on the vision. When we are looking over at our neighbor and comparing ourselves, we are not focused on the vision that God is drawing us to. There is room for everyone to bring their gifts to contribute when we admit our need and our lack. So today, we are making our estimates of giving, and I will, at that time, I'll remind you then, ask you to think of a blessing that God gives you through your church, and I will ask you to think of a need, a place of lack. We are not here because we have arrived at the dream of God. We're not there yet. We're still on the yellow brick road. We are here at Trinity because we are traveling that road toward God's dream together, and we need each other. We need everyone's gifts to get there. May God give us God's vivid and beautiful dream and humble us to admit our need for each other. May God help us to be vulnerable about our lack and to see it not as a liability, but as a way to remain open to relationship and community. May God guide us through many forests and obstacles until we arrive at that dream together and all are at home. May the peace which passes all understanding keep our hearts and minds in Jesus the Christ. Amen. I invite you to sing our hymn, "We Are an Offering." You may rise in body or spirit. Let us confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
In gratitude and humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all God's creation. God of mercy, you are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Inspire your church to serve and love all people with the unceasing grace you extend to us. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all creation, you formed a world where even the sparrow finds a home. Preserve the beauty and diversity of all creatures with whom we share the earth. Lead us to protect all living things. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of peace, you are an ever-present help in times of trouble. Rescue families and nations torn apart by violence and warfare, especially Russia and Ukraine.
Unite all people toward common goals of reconciliation and peace for every person. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of hope, you stand with the suffering and give strength. Comfort your people filled with fear or anger, anxiety or shame. Bring healing to all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit, especially all affected by COVID-19, all affected by wildfires and hurricanes. Jeannie, Denise Spain, Steve Chittister, and all we name before you now, aloud or silently. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of restoration, you call us to trust in you and not ourselves alone. Make this congregation a community of humility and repentance, ready to encounter you in love and follow in your ways. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of eternal life, to you be the glory forever. We give you thanks for all who have fought the good fight, finished the race, kept the faith, and now live with you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ is with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with each other. Yeah, we good? For those of you who are visiting today, we do not expect you to fill out an estimate of giving card. You can take this time to pray or look at your phone, I guess. For the rest of you who received an envelope this morning or a card, I invite you to open your envelope and pull out the yellow card inside, which has there's an estimate of giving card, yeah, the yellow one. And so I invite you now to just hold it for a second and to hold in your mind a blessing from God that comes through Trinity Lutheran Church. And I'm sure it just flew into your brain very quickly. And so I will also invite you to think about a place of need or lack and to hold that also in your mind. And now I'll let you fill out your card. We will be putting these in the offering basket in a few minutes.
If we already have your address, then you probably don't have to put that on there. Oh, Rachel's going to have my hide. Let us pray. Gracious God, in your great love, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing, and make us ready to share with all in need through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all. Amen. Amen. I invite you to stand in body or spirit. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks and praise to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Savior Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks to God and gave it for all to drink. He said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." God, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Today we will have two stations, again, for Holy Communion. You will be given the wafer, unless you specifically ask for the pod, and the pod contains everything that you need for communion. But if you receive the wafer, then you'll want to move to the cups. The red liquid is wine, and the white liquid is grape juice. We do have gluten-free available upon request. Just let us know if that's what you require. You can take your communion right then and there, or you can take it back at your seat. Either way, at some point, your empty cup will go into the basket so that the altar guild can take good care of it. Everyone is welcome at God's table. Christ invites you. Come, taste, and see. the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of the abundant table, you have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your grace on the road, that we might serve our neighbors with joy. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to dedicate this piano. You're going to say some things, Hillary? All right, you all can be seated. This is going to take a minute.
So Lynn Stone, who couldn't be here today, works for a company that does estate sales. And she let Connie and Scott know a few months back that she was working on the estate sale of a woman who had this gorgeous old grand piano. And thanks to some amazing memorial gifts made by and or in memory of Roger and Jackie Germanson and Marjorie Anderson and Bruce Burmeister, we were able to acquire this beautiful piano. And so it's going to live in the fellowship hall most of the time, but it's also on this cool dolly so it can be moved around so we can do stuff like this today. So first of all, it's thanks to all of those people who made it possible. Also, we wanted to give a special note today. We have Connie and Scott and Sonia and me playing, but who we don't have with us today is Rachel Jamego, who's been rehearsing with us and was going to play with us on our second song, but she had sickness in her family this morning and couldn't get a last minute babysitter and tried. She wanted to be here, so she'll join us for another one down the road. But yeah, so we'll turn it over to Pastor to dedicate this piano for us.
Siblings in Christ, today we seek God's blessing as we gather with thankfulness to set apart this baby grand piano, whose name is Elizabeth, right? This is William, this is Elizabeth. We set this apart to God's glory. God has given us the gift of music, and to God we sound our praise. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of the universe. You have made the whole earth after your glory. All your creatures praise you. We lift our voices to join the sounds and song of heaven and earth, of things seen and unseen, in praise of your glory. You alone do great wonders, and by your wisdom you made the heavens and the earth. All living things give you praise. You have breathed your breath of mercy into your children, to hear from them a joyful shout with their own song. In the fullness of time, O God, you sang your new song, our Savior Jesus Christ, who is exalted by poets, musicians, and all your saints. Your spirit is the breath of our music and song. Be with us now and bless us as we dedicate this baby grand piano to your praise and glory. Enrich the lives of your people through it, and grant us faith to hear your gracious purpose in it. By your Holy Spirit, let this piano enliven the proclamation of your word to the building up of your church, to the glory of your name, and to the good of all your people, through Jesus Christ, our Savior, through ages of ages. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, before whose throne trumpets sound, and saints and angels sing songs of Moses and the Lamb, accept this piano for the worship of your church, that with the voice of music, we may proclaim your praise and tell it abroad through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. God bless you and keep you. God's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. God look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So I have our sending hymn as Guide My Feet, but I see you're all sitting here at the pianos. Okay, we're going to have a duet for this too? Whoa, I'm so excited and impressed. Two verses of Guide My Feet, verses 1 and 2, and you'll probably want to rise to sing.
Guide my feet, my heart.
treats are indoors today, and so you're invited. There is whipped cream.